Well, he was a stickler for reality, Robert Reed. Not a stickler for comedy.
Yeah.
Comedy was the last thing in his mind. He would read a script in one hand, and in the other hand, he had the Encyclopedia Britannica. So everything had to be according to his version of the truth,
yeah,
which he found in factual things. So I had a good idea for a story, an episode of The Brady Bunch. And so it depended on putting a payphone in their home to teach kids that,
yeah,
you don't hog the phone all the time with your,
yeah,
teenage friends. Your parents have to use it. And in order to enforce that dictum,
mm-hmm,
they'd have to pay for each phone call. But I also knew that Bob Reed was going to read this script, and he's going to say it's illegal for a private house to have a payphone. So I learned to take the bull by the horn before I even knew it was a bull.
Yeah.
Because it's too late once. I called Washington, D.C. and said, is it okay for anybody to put a private phone in their home?
A payphone.
Payphone in their home. And they said, no, there's certain little areas where it's possible. I said, are there any in Southern California? And they said, yeah, there's an area in Santa Monica. I said, I had read about a very famous millionaire, who wanted a payphone in his house. Maybe that's how he became a millionaire.
J. Paul Getty.
J. Paul Getty. He had a payphone in his house. So knowing Bob's reaction to anything that required research, I sent him a copy of the script. He immediately said, this is ridiculous. I said, no, it's possible. He said, where does the Brady Bunch live?
Yeah.
I said, well, you ought to know, it's Southern California. And he said, I know it's Southern California. This time I had him.
Yeah.
And so he said, Southern California, I said, in the Los Angeles area. He said, I know that too. I see palm trees every week. I said, it's actually, it's in Santa Monica. And he slammed the receiver down. He was furious that I had outwitted him.
Yeah, but how awful to have this every day, because once, yeah, you've got it, it's hard to replace one of the stars of the show, because unless you've got an absolute doppelganger who can, yeah, come in. And you had to live with that year after year. It was interesting, too, Lloyd, how your career grew as you got older and with the show.
Yeah. Yeah.
From being sort of dialogue director, camp counselor, you became an associate producer.
Right. An associate producer, and I actually directed some, and then we ended up producing and then executive producing together. And I was the youngest producer in the business at the time,
mm-hmm,
when youth wasn't as a premium as it is now.
Yeah.
And that was very interesting, and I give Dad a lot of credit because, you know, he put himself on the line for me because,
yeah,
he said, this is the guy who's doing it, and he pointed to me. And but we worked so well together because,
yeah,
a lot of times within the shows, I would represent the kid point of view.
The Brady Bunch. And you wrote the lyrics to,
yeah,
that song.
Yeah. Well, I learned from a previous song, from a previous show, how important a song can be.
Yeah.
And that was from Gilligan's Island,
yeah,
where I used the song to sell the show.
Yeah.
So the first thing I did as soon as I was going to do another show was to write the theme for the Brady Bunch.
What was also how the kids grew,
yeah,
within the show, that at certain points, they seemed almost too close together as far,
yeah,
as male-female.
Yeah, well, I don't think he described it to me this way, but I think my job a lot of times was to throw cold water on them.
As they got older.
Yeah. And they were, fortunately for the older ones, Maureen had a crush on Barry, Barry had a crush on Maureen, and it usually was at different times.
Yeah. So you didn't have, let me hold up a couple of the pictures here because they really are just beautiful in the book for anybody who's a fan, which most people are, of that period, to remember how they looked at in the beginning.
Oh, yeah.
That's how they looked.
Yeah. And Anne B. Davis, her role.
Yeah.
Well, she's magnificent as a comedy performer and as a person, which is important, too.
She and Florence, I mean, because Florence Henderson is truly a superstar.
Yeah, she is.
I mean, whether it's on the stage or whether it was in motion pictures or on TV, she's a star.
A lovely person, too. And here's some more of the pictures here that really deserve to be seen, including my guest, Lloyd.
Well, I haven't changed.
No. But the story, too, of you at King's Island.
Yes. Yeah, that was an interesting thing because we were going to King's Island and...
Of course, you had a brilliant director for that show.
Yes, we did. It's a guy named Les Martinson.
Yes.
I don't know. Are you aware of him?
Oh, yeah. As a matter of fact, our daughter, who was about 11 at the time, played an extra, I think, at a table.
Oh, good. Good. Well, it was because we were going back there, and then we had to kind of, we didn't want to bring other actors back, because that would have cost a lot of money, and so we had to find people who could do the roles, and Les ended up doing a role, and I ended up doing a role. He was my first and only director, by the way.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, well, good.
And Les, as a matter of fact, directed a very important a show in my life and in his, I'm sure, and that was The Rescue from Gilligan's Island.
Largest audience in America ever had.
Yeah.
I mean, when you see today, they say 5 million, what was it, 52 million people watched.
52 million people watched that show. It's in the top 10 shows of all TV shows. Yeah.
And here are some more of the pictures that are in this book. I think it's the Jesse James as well.
And Les directed that one, too.
And that was an interesting psychological bit that you ran into with the network.
The first problem on that show was we were going to do it about hijacking, where Bobby idolized a hijacker. Yeah. And the network, properly, I think we both agree with them, said so much of the show he was idolizing this hijacker, and it would not have been, if somebody tuned out, the hijacker would have been a hero.
Yeah. I mean, the way the story turned out, Bobby was led to understand that he was no hero. He was a terrible person.
Yeah.
But if somebody tuned out before the end, they felt it was a bad thing to leave it taste like that in the kid's mouth.
Playing with children can be a problem. The fact you began the series with the wedding of Mike and Carol, and I love the whole thing that the wedding cake fell and how that all worked out to be great humor. But after the 5 years later, very Brady Christmas.
Right.
The Brady girls get married.
Right.
And then you had another series that you were going to do with the Brady Brides.
The Brady Bride.
It was a short-lived series, and then we did it as a drama, and then there was the feature films. The Brady's just keeps going.
But Lloyd, you kept saying, and I do think it's an important book also for anybody who wants to be in film, show business, etc., because it isn't always easy. And you can own an idea. They can love it, and they'll say, we're putting our writers on it.